أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Can we start with a really loud salawat? اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. رمضان كريم. So can I hear you say the answer? Let me see. I can hear you. A really loud resounding Allahu Akram. Okay. Well, let's start again with Quran first. And the ayah that hopefully now you have memorized. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. You have to recite the Quran as it ought to be recited. And Imam Ali mentions two things. One was tajweed, which was the pronunciation of the huruf, of the letters. And the other was waqf, or how to stop. Yesterday, we looked at qalqala. Do you remember that? So qalqala was when you had a bit of an echo for five letters. And I said, if you can remember, don't be quick to jump. Don't for da, b for ba, quick for qa, tu for ta, and ja for jump. Whenever you came to those letters at the end of a sentence, or if I had a sukoon on it, you had to have a slight echo. Not as much as to go into fatha, but a small echo. Today, we're going to look at those things that are called mad. Mad means to stretch, like really stretch, right? So if you, for example, had a fatha on top of a letter, say you had it on top of a meme, it would be m, right? If you had a standing one, you would say ma. But if you had this squiggle, it's like a stroke or a curve on top of the letter, it's called a mad, which means to stretch. If it's a very light mud, like you can see it's a light stroke, it's a light curve on top of the letter, then you would only stretch it four times. And it's the time it takes you to open four fingers. So say we had m with a light stroke on it, you would go ma, and you've got four fingers. If it's a dark, thick one, then you would have five or six fingers. So you'd go ma, see, like that. So In the surah we're going to recite, which is Surah Al-Tariq, you'll find there are two places where there's a madda, and hopefully we will be able to look at them and with our fingers be able to have five stretches of them. Okay, you good with that? All right. So we're going to recite Surah Al-Tariq, but before we recite it, let's have a little understanding of it. There's 17 ayat. It's quite a short surah. And Tariq actually means that brilliant night star. If you were to look at the sky, and the less pollution the better these days, it's not that much pollution because there's not many cars around, so many airplanes flying around, so obviously it's a little bit nicer to look outside. And when you look outside at night, you will see one star sort of twinkles a lot more. Okay, so that's known as Tariq. It's also known as a night visitor. Let me explain to you why. Because Tariq comes from the Arabic word Taraka, and Taraka means to strike, you know, to stomp your feet, or to pound something. Even when you take a hammer to pound something, to hit something, that's taraka. Tariq is specific to those who travel at night, because travelers who travel at night, they stamp on the ground, they walk on the ground to travel. Even at night, when you want to knock on somebody's door and you knock on it, really, you strike the door, you knock on it hard to open it at night. Now, in this surah, you will see that Allah starts off by saying, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ. I swear by the heaven, which is everything above. Samawat is seven heavens. I swear by the heavens and this amazing, brilliant star. Imam Sadiq says it's Saturn, because Saturn, that's the planet that's sort of so way away in the seventh heaven. He says its light passes the skies and reaches the fair sky. And that's why Allah has called it the star of piercing brightness. He's called it actually in this surah, Najmu Thaqib. Najm is a star. Okay, Thaqib is like brilliant, laser sharp. Now, what does this surah talk about? What is it about this surah? What does it say? Well, the focus of this surah is when you look at that brilliant night star, whether you're looking at the most sparkling star there or Saturn, as Imam tells us, then you have to think of two things. One, you have to think of the journey of light of that star, of how much that light has come across from that planet to us, but also that this star, this light has a camera in it. We are being watched. It's like the big brother. Remember yesterday we talked about Buruj, about this constellation, this massive fort, so lots of angels with lots of cameras. Well, this is the brightest camera out and the brightest light out. So it's saying we are being watched. The surah also talks about the journey of the cells that create a human being. So a human being is created. Then it talks about how he will return back to his Rabb and his secrets will all be out and they will all be tested. So it's always best to have the best of secrets. So if I can say, Tariq, you think of that bright star, you think about it guiding and recording. Can you remember that? So Tariq, guiding and recording. It shows us the way, but it's also recording absolutely everything we're doing. A bit like what I'm doing now. It records everything. Okay. All right. So shall we recite the surah? Will you recite it with me? Have you got it ready? Do you know which number surah it is? You're right. 86. Let's start. Oh, there's one thing I forgot to tell you about it. The benefits of reciting this surah. Oh, I completely forgot. So Imam Sadiq says that if you recite it before you take any medicine, then the medicine will work better on you. He also said that if you recited it on some water and poured it over a cut that you might have or a wound that you might have, it'll help to heal it. Now always remember, dawa and dua, medicine and this together. When I grew up, my grandma, my goodness, she was awesome. So she had these tiny little bottles in the fridge, right? And they were all labeled from 1 to 114. She had all the surahs in there. So if something was hurting, she would say, take your medicine, but take a few drops of that particular surah. And she knew them all. It's like amazing. So for example, for a tummy ache, she'd say 111, okay? So if it was something like we got cut, because when you fall, you get hurt, she would say, 86. And it's really important that we use both these together. All right, let's recite the surah. I nearly started A'udhu Billah. What did I forget? La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. A'udhu Billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. والسماء طارق وما أدراك ما الطارق النجم الثاقب إن كل نفس لما عليها حافظ فلينظر الإنسان مما خلق خلق مما إن دافق يخرج من بين السلب والتراب ترايب إنه على رجعه لقادر يوم تبلى السرائر فما له من قوة ولا ناصر والسماء ذات الرجع والعرض ذات الصدع إنه لقول فصل وما هو بالحزل إنهم يكيدون كيدا وأكيد كيدا فمحل الكافرين أمهلهم رويدا صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق الرسول الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Right, let's read the du'as now. Got your books ready? Right, we're going to start with Ya Aliyu Ya Azim. And you should know this by now. You know how we're going to do it. So we'll continue reading it until we get to du'al iftitah. Okay. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. Ya Aliyu Ya Azim. Ya Ghafuru Ya Rahim. أنت الرب العظيم الذي ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير وهذا شهر أذمته وكرمته وشرفته وفضلته على الشهور وهو الشهر الذي فرضت صيامه عليه وهو شهر رمضان الذي أنزلت فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان وجعلت فيه ليلة القدر وجعلتها خيرا من ألف شهر فيا ذا المن ولا يمن عليك من علي بفكاك رقبتي من النار في من تمن عليه وادخلني الجنة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم أدخل على أهل القبور السرور. اللهم أغني كل فقير. اللهم أشبع كل جائع. اللهم اكس كل عريان. اللهم اقض دين كل مدين. اللهم فرج عن كل مكروب. اللهم رد كل غريب. اللهم فك كل أسير. اللهم أصلح كل فاسد من أمور المسلمين. اللهم اشف كل مريض. اللهم سد فقرنا بغناك. اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك. اللهم اقض عنا الدين وأغننا من الفقر. إنك على كل شيء قدير. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم رب شهر رمضان الذي أنزلت فيه القرآن وافترضت على عبادك فيه الصيام صل على محمد وآل محمد وارزقني حج بيتك الحرام في عام هذا وفي كل عام واغفر لي تلك الذنوب العظام فإنه لا يغفرها غيرك يا رحمن يا علام. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. So we will now read Dua al-Iftitah. Iftitah is to open. It is taught by Imam Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Farajah, to be recited every day in the month of Ramadan. And I'm going to draw your attention to a few bits when we're reciting so you can focus on them. So we start off by saying, Allahumma inni aftatihu thana'a bihamdi. Oh Allah, I start with your hamd. And hamd was, remember, praise and gratitude. Then Allahumma adhinta li fi du'aika. You allowed me to call out to you wa mas'alatik and to ask you. Fasma ya sami'u midhati. Listen to my praise of you. Wa ajib ya rahimu da'wati. Answer my du'as. Wa aqil ya ghafuru athrati. And make little my mistakes. Okay. Then I need to draw your attention and you say, Allahumma inni as'aluka. Oh Allah, I ask. Kalilam, a little bit. Min kathirin ma hajatin bi ilahi azima. From so much that you have. But for me, it's so big, right? For you, it's so little. Wa ghinaka anhu kadim. You are needless of it. You don't need it. But for me, wa huwa indi kathir. It's so much. Wa huwa alayka sahlun yaseer. For you, it is like so easy to give it to me. And then obviously, we're going to go through the hamd as we go along. But today, I'd look at section 9, okay? Now, section 9 again is alhamd. So we say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi laysa lahu munazi'un yu'adilu. All praise is for him. All praise and gratitude is for him who has no equal who can debate with him or argue with him. He's way above. Wala shabihun yushakilu. There is no one similar to him. Shabih is like somebody's mirror image. There's no one like you. Wala dhahirun yu'adidu. There's no helper to support him. Kahara bi'izzatihi al-a'izza. He overpowers those who think they are mighty with his strength. وَتَوَاذَعَ لِأَذَمَتِهِ الْعُظَمَى. Even the great people of the world humble themselves before his awesomeness. فَبَلَغَ بِكُدْرَتِهِ مَا يَشَى. He does, he finishes, he accomplishes whatever he wants through his power. What an awesome God you and I have. My goodness, he is just amazing. Okay, all right, let's start. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma inni aftatihu thana'a bihamdik. Wa anta musaddidun lis-sawabi bimannik. وايقنت انك انت ارحم الراحمين في موضع العفو والرحمه، واشد المعاقبين في موضع النكال والنقمه، واعظم المتجبرين في موضع الكبرياء والعظمه. اللهم اذنت لي في دعائك ومسالتك، فاسمع يا سميع مدحتي، وعجب يا رحيم دعوتي، وأقل يا غفور وثرتي. فكم يا إلهي من كربة قد فرجتها، وهموم قد كشفتها، وعثرة قد أقلتها، ورحمة قد نشرتها، وحلقتي بلايا قد فككتها. الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا، ولم يكن له شريك في الملك، ولم يكن له ولي من الذل، وكبره تكبيرا. الله أكبر. الحمد لله بجميع محامده كلها، على جميع نعمه كلها. الحمد لله الذي لا مضاد له في ملكه، ولا منازع له في أمري. الحمد لله الذي لا شريك له في خلقي، ولا شبيه له في عظمتي. الحمد لله الفاشي في الخلق أمره وحمده، الظاهر بالكرم مجده، الباسط بالجود يده، الذي لا تنقص خزائنه ولا تزيده كثرة العطاء إلا جودا وكرما، إنه هو العزيز الوهاب. اللهم إني أسألك قليلا من كثير، مع حاجة بي إليه عظيمة، وغناك عنه قديم، وهو عندي كثير، وهو عليك سهل يسير. اللهم إنا عفوك عن ذنبي، وتجاوزك عن خطيئتي، وصفحك عن ظلمي، وسترك على قبيح عملي، وحلمك عن كثير جرمي عندما كان من خطئي وعمدي. أتمعني في أن أسألك ما لا أستوجبه منك، الذي رزقتني من رحمتك، وعريتني من قدرتك، وعرفتني من إجابتك، فصرت عدوك آمنا وأسألك مستعنسا، لا خائفا ولا وجلا، مدلا عليك فيما قصدت فيه إليك. فإن ابتعني يتبت بجهلي عليك، ولعل الذي يبتعني هو خير لي لإلمك بعاقبة الأمور. فلما مولا كريما أصبر على عبد لئيم منك عليه، يا ربي إنك تدعوني فأولي عنك، وتتحببوا إلي فتبغضوا إليك، وتتوددوا إلي فلا أقبل منك، كأن لي التطول عليك. فلم يمنعك ذلك من الرحمة لي والإحسان إلي والتفضل علي بجودك وكرمك. فارحم عبدك الجاهل، وجد عليه بفضل إحسانك، إنك جواد كريم. الحمد لله مالك الملك، مجري الفلك، مسخر الرياح، فالك الأسباح، ديان الدين، رب العالمين. الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمي، والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرتي، والحمد لله على طول أناته في غضبي، وهو قادر على ما يريد. الحمد لله خالق الخلق، باسط الرزق، فالك الأسباب، ذي الجلال والإكرام والفضل والإنعام، الذي بعد فلا يرى، وقرب فشهد النجوى، تبارك وتعالى. الحمد لله الذي ليس له منازع يعادله، ولا شبيه يشاكل، ولا ظهير يعاضد، كحرب عزته العزة، وتواضع لعظمته العظمى، فبلغ بقدرته ما يشاء. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Can I have a salawat please? A really loud one. اللهم صل على Muhammad or Ali Muhammad. So now we come to the month of Ramadan. And we started off by looking at our days. And we started off with Sehri. That's where our day starts, okay? So today your day should have started at, I think it was 3:24. Is that right? If I got it right? But you'd have started a little bit earlier. Say about 3 o'clock. So 3 o'clock, you might have had some Sehri. And then you might have recited Salatul Layl or prayed Salatul Layl. And then Fajr was at about 3:24. Am I right? I don't know whether I've got the times right. I think I have. 3:24, is that right? Okay. So then we looked at the day and I said, we have to structure our day around Salah. So Ramadan is all about the Quran and that's what we've been doing. It's about fasting and we're doing that. And it's about Salah and Dua and we're doing Dua as well. So we're going to look at Salah. And we've been looking at the A to Z of Salah. And you should have got a book. My front cover, and you should have had the front cover. You can download it from the website qfatima.com. And then we wrote in it, and I think you might have a better one than I do because I'm not very good at drawing. So I had A for Adhan, then we had B for book because we're going to divide it into separate sections. We had C for connect. Do you remember the heart? Oh, I'm going to try and show it to you. There you go. The heart, the presence of the heart, and the focusing on the words. Then we had D for dua. You remember my dua? I drew around my hands and I put the most important duas that I know in here. And maybe I'll put lots more around there as well. Then yesterday, we looked at E for essential. Do you remember that? And on one page, I've put the 11 wajibat of salah. And on the other page, I've put the 5 essentials. Can you remember what the 5 essentials were? Try. See if you can remember. The first one was niyya. The second one was takbiratul ihram. The third one was Qiyam. But Qiyam, which Qiyam? The one during Takbiratul Ihram and the one before Ruku. We'll talk about these when we do these things. The fourth one, Ruku. And the fifth one was the two sajdas together. Now, these are known as Rukn, the pillars. If we forget these, even in error, even not intentionally, unintentionally, you have to start praying again. With the other 6 wajibat, we can do different things. So remember the other 6? There was Qir'at, which is reciting the Quran when you're standing. There was Zikr, which we recite in whether we're in Ruku or Sijda or Julus. There was Tashahud. There was Salam. Do you remember the last 2? What were they? Tartib and Mualat. And Tartib, remember what that meant? That meant we have to pray in sequence. You can't do Sijda first and then Ruku. You have to pray in sequence. And Mualat was not no gaps in between. You got to go one after the other. Okay, so today we're going to look at F. Can anybody guess what F is for? Try and think what I put F for. It's really important, really, really important. In the sermon of the Prophet, he said, the most unfortunate in this month is the one who isn't, you're right, forgiven. So it's forgiveness, okay? Now, really important in Salah, forgiveness, my goodness. So let's first talk a little bit about where we recite it in Sajda or in Salah. And then we will find out what it actually means. What is forgiveness? What does it mean? Okay. It's different from repentance, from tawbah. That's very different. This is called istighfar. That is called tawbah. They're 2 different things. So first of all, most of us, in between the 2 sajdas, when we sit up, we say, astaghfirullah rabbi wa atubu ilayh. We say, I seek forgiveness from my Rabb and I turn, I make a U-turn to him. Although, in between these 2 sajdas, you don't have to say anything. You can stay quiet. But we say that. Now, let's first understand what that means. So, in Surah Taha, that's Surah number 20, Ayah 55, Allah says, Minha khalaqnakum. We created you from it. From what? From dust. Remember Amor? The sajdaga that we do our sajda on, what is that? That is made out of dirt, of dust. But it's really special to us because it contains a little bit of the dust of Karbala. Because that was the best sajda done by Imam Hussein. That's another story altogether. So, minha khalaqnakum. We've created you from dust. Wa fiha nu'idukum. And we will return you back to dust. That means when we die, we will be returned back to dust. Then he says, wa minha nukhrijukum. Then we will raise you again from there. Taratan ukhra. A second time. So Imam Ali says, that is sajda. Whenever you do sajda, you got to remember this ayah. When you go into the first sajda, when you're in there, that's when you come up, you're actually being born. When you go back, you're dying. So in between the two sajdas is your life and the whole of our lives. We're saying Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa Atubu Ilayh. There's something else that's recommended to recite it rather than Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa Atubu Ilayh. It's good to recite that, but let me tell you what you can recite. And I'll try and put it up for you as a thing on the website, or we can put a link for you. You have to say, Allahumma ghfirli. Not have to. You choose to say, Allahumma ghfirli. Oh Allah, forgive me. You know, look at it, listen to me, and maybe think about it today. And then I'll write it up for you, and then you can practice it. Warhamni, and have mercy on me. Wajburni, and fix me. So first we say, forgive me. Then we say, be kind to me. Now you've forgiven me, be kind to me. I'm a bit broken though, because I've done these things that are not very good. So wajburni, fix me. And then we say, wadfa'anni. So now this is a little bit, how am I going to say this? Wadfa'anni means protect me now. I don't want to do this again. And then we say, wa'afini, and make me be well. Like, you know, this sin has really broken me up. It's made me feel sad. It's made me broken. So make me feel all round better. And then you see, inni lima anzaltu ilayya min khairin faqir. I'm asking you of whatever good you send down to me. Tabarakallahu rabbul alameen. And Allah gives barakah. Barakah means more than we deserve. And also he sort of enlivens or brings out that which was sleeping in us, the goodness that was sleeping in us. Now part of this dua, where we say, inni lima anzaltu ilayya min khairin faqir, is a dua of Prophet Musa. Maybe one day we'll talk about it. So this is something we can recite between two sajdas. Do you remember what I said? Allahumma firli, Allah, forgive me. Then be kind to me. Think about it. Be kind to me. Wajburni, then fix me. Wadfa'anni, protect me. I don't want this sin again. Wa'afini, and make me good all the way around. Make me well all the way around. And then, inni lima anzaltu ilayya min khairin faqir. I want whatever good's coming down from you. It's such a beautiful dua. So now let's talk a little bit about what forgiveness is. There was a teacher in a class who said to his class, and the class, all little children, and he said, what do you have to do to get God's forgiveness? And a little boy put up his hand and he said, you have to sin. You have to do something wrong to get his forgiveness. And that makes sense. So he is just so awesome. So if you look at the Quran, Allah says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Muhammad, tell them, oh you who have done wrong to your soul, لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Never, ever, ever despair in the mercy of Allah. Never think, oh, Allah will never forgive me. Because he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah forgives all sins. My goodness, I love it. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. He is all forgiving and all merciful. The Prophet said, being ashamed of one's sin is tawbah. Imam Sadiq says, there is no person who Allah did not forgive who had felt ashamed of his misdeed. And whenever somebody feels ashamed of his faults and asks Allah for forgiveness, Allah forgives all his sins. Can you just imagine? Just feeling bad about it. We call him ghafir al-dhamb. The one who forgives thumb. And remember, I've spoken about thumb a lot of times. It's that sin that's like a tail. Thumb is like a tail. Kind of follows you all the time. Something that's shameful. You don't want to know it. And it's those hidden voices inside us that torment us. Now let's see what istighfar means. I said it was forgiveness. But what does it really mean? Al-ghifar is a helmet. You know, like a hat. Maybe like my scarf. It's not a scarf, actually. It's a helmet that you wear that you protect your head with. So if you go on a bicycle, you know you got to wear a helmet. Motorbike, you got to wear a helmet. You must do that to protect yourself. Every time you wear the helmet or you see one, remember it is al-ghifar. It protects. Istighfar, when I do istighfar, I'm asking Allah to protect me from the mistakes that I make, from the effects of the mistakes that I make. And in between sajda, can you imagine? It's like our life. We're saying, my whole life, I'm going to be protected from wrong so I can do lots of good, lots of right. Okay. Remember in the dua that we read, Ya Aliyu Ya Azim, Ya Ghafuru Ya Rahim. So there are lots of names of Allah. So let's see what they are. Ghafir. Ghafir is he who forgives your faults from other people. Ghafur is the one who forgives your faults from, oh, hides, not forgives, hides your faults from the angels and from everybody else. People whom you can't see. Ghaffar is when he hides your faults from yourself. Because sometimes when we've done something wrong and we tried to correct it, we've done our best, but it still haunts us. Ya Allah, Ya Ghaffar, help me forget it. So if I say Ghafur, if I say who Allah is, He is one who hides my faults. Can you imagine if people knew the things that we did? My goodness, wouldn't be very good. Now let's look at some hadith and then we'll go into Suratul Ankabut. So the Prophet said that Allah said, O son of Adam, that is all of us, as long as you call me and you ask me, I shall forgive you for whatever you have done. And I don't mind. If your sins were to reach the clouds of the sky and you were to then ask forgiveness of me, I would forgive you. O son of Adam, were you to come to me with sins nearly as great as the earth and were you then to face me and you would believe in me and me alone as your Rabb, as your God, I would bring you forgiveness nearly as great at it. One of the du'as we're going to read on the 13th, 14th and 15th of Ramadan is known as Du'a al-Mujib. And I remember that because that du'a says, if your sins are as many as the raindrops that fall from the sky, as the leaves that fall in autumn, as the sand that is on the beaches, on you know, near the sea, my goodness, Allah forgives all those sins. But a word of caution. If I have done something wrong to somebody else, He doesn't forgive that. You have to go and say sorry. You have to put it right. And if you feel you can't say sorry because it's going to be really, really difficult for you for whatever reason at all, or you've forgotten, then you must do something good for them. I'm going to tell you a story about my childhood so you know what I'm talking about. I remember one day going to visit somebody with my mama. And we went to this person's house and I was so bored because they were talking adult talk. I must have been about 5 or 6. And in her sofa, she had a sofa, and in her sofa there was a hole. And I remember putting my finger through that hole and picking out some of the stuffing that was in there. And I forgot all about it. But when I grew up, I had a little bit of akal, you know what akal is? A little bit of thinking and understanding. I thought, oh my God, in my pocket I had stolen a bit of the stuffing from her sofa. Now what do I do? I didn't know who she was. I have no idea. I didn't want to tell my mom who did we go to because it would confuse her even more. And it troubled me for a long time. So then there is a concept called radde mazalim, which means you rub out the injustice, the wrong that you've done. And I thought, well, I need to at least give some money in sadaqah for her. Maybe pray 2 rakat salah. Maybe also read some Quran for her. So that maybe on the day of judgment, when she says, you stole a little bit from my sofa, you stole a little bit of stuffing, I can say, but look, I did all this good for you. I did good in your name. So it's really important to know that forgiveness doesn't mean I say astaghfirullah, rabbi wa atubu ilayhi, and everything is suddenly rubbed out. Those are different sins. That's with God. But with people, we must put them right. It's really, really important that we do that. You good? Okay. So now we're going to look at Suratul Ankabut. Are you ready for Suratul Ankabut? You know what surah number it is? It's written over there. It's surah number 29. Okay. Now, we divided it into 8 sections, do you remember? And we looked at the first section. We've already looked at that first section. And the first section was walk the talk. Everything is going to be tested. When you say we believe, it doesn't stay there. It's going to be tested. And we looked at Bilal, and we looked at Ammar, and we looked at Khabbab ibn Arad, and Sa'ad. Do you know who it was? Who was it? Do you remember who we looked at? Sa'ad ibn Waqqas, do you remember? Whose mom refused to eat because he followed Muhammad. And she said, I'm not going to eat. And then she saw he was so lovely and so kind and never shouted at her, nothing. Kept on telling her, Mama, he's right. And eventually she agrees to eat. So these are all the people that were tested. So that was our first section. But we've gone on to the second section where we're looking at the past prophets who were tested. And before I do that, we're going to recite it. And you're going to recite it with me. Can you do that? Okay, so find the surah and we'll recite it together, okay? I forgot. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alif lam mim. أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فليعلمن الله الذين صدقوا وليعلمن الكاذبين أم حسب الذين يعملون السيئات أن يسبقونا ساء ما يحكمون من كان يرجو لقاء الله فإن أجل الله لآت وهو السميع العليم ومن جاهد فإنما يجاهد لنفسه إن الله لغني عن العالمين. You remember the jihad from there? That was trying hard to do your best. Now the next ayah tells us, the best in what? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَنُكَفِّرَنَّ عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَحْسَنَ الَّذِي كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So we've got to do our best in believing, and that believing has to show in عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And we talked about عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. You remember those deeds that fix people. And what will Allah do? He will cover our evil and He'll give us the best of rewards. And then the ayah for parents, which we're going to read now. وَوَسَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ لِتُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا إِلَيَّ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Your Lord, or Allah says, your Rabb, He has made it wajib for you to be really good to your parents. It is only when they ask you to do something that is against Allah, when they ask you to do wrong things, that you will not obey them, but you will never stop respecting them. Never, ever. So we talked about that. We had a whole lesson on it. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ فِي الصَّالِحِينَ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ فَإِذَا أُوذِيَ فِي اللَّهِ جَعَلَ فِتْنَةَ النَّاسِ كَأَذَابِ اللَّهِ وَلَئِنْ جَاءَ نَصْرٌ مِّن رَّبِّكَ لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّا كُنَّا مَعَكُمْ أَوَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَعْلَمَ بِمَا فِي صُدُورِ الْعَالَمِينَ وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّبِعُوا سَبِيلَنَا وَلْنَحْمِلْ خَطَايَاكُمْ وَمَا هُمْ بِحَامِلِينَ مِنْ خَطَايَاهُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِنَّهُمْ لَكَاذِبُونَ وَلَيَحْمِلُنَّ أَثْقَالَهُمْ وَأَثْقَالًا مَعَ أَثْقَالِهِمْ وَلَيُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ. So here, we're told that nobody is going to carry our burdens. Nobody can say, well, come, let's do bad things together and I will take all the blame. They won't do that. You have to carry your own burdens. Yesterday, we talked about Prophet Nuh. Now see if in these two ayat, you can think about him. وَلَكَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ عَامًا فَأَخَذَهُمُ الطُّوفَانُ وَهُمْ ظَالِمُونَ. Remember, أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ is 1,000. إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ except 50. You did the math yesterday. He lived amongst his people for 950 years. Then there was طوفان. طوفان is the storm or the flood. وَهُمْ ظَالِمُونَ because they were unjust. فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُ أَصْحَابَ السَّفِينَةِ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا آيَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We saved him and the people in the safina. Safina is the ark. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا آيَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we made them a sign for the worlds. So now we're going to look at Prophet Ibrahim. So we find here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about him. And it's quite a lot of ayat that talk about him. It goes from 16 right down to 27, okay? So we're going to go through each one quickly, a little bit, and then I'll tell you his story. So the first one says, "Wa Ibrahim," and Ibrahim, "Idh qala li qawmihi," when he told his people, "E abadullah, believe in Allah, be the slaves of Allah, submit to Him, wattaqu, be God conscious, dhalikum khayrul lakum in kuntum ta'malun, in kuntum ta'lamun, that's better for you if only you knew." He told them, "Innama ta'buduna min dunillahi awthanan, you're worshipping idols other than Allah. Wa takhluquna ifkan, and you're creating lies. Innal ladhina ta'buduna min dunillahi, those who obey other than Allah, لا يملكون لكم رزقا فابتغوا عند الله الرزق. They're not going to get any sustenance. Seek your sustenance from Allah. واعبدوه, be his slaves, واشكروا له. Thank him. إليه ترجعون. To him you will return. So I'm going to look at those two ayat, tell you the story, and then we'll recite the rest of it. Okay? So let's start with Prophet Ibrahim. You ready? It's going to be story time now. So there was a king and his name was Namrud. Okay, Namrud lived in a place called Kutha. Kutha as in K-U-T-H-A, which is very near where Kufa is now. So you can't forget Kufa and Kutha. He had an advisor. Kings have advisors. Do you know that? So he had an advisor who was also an astrologer. Do you know what an astrologer is? It's somebody who looks at the planets and the stars and he tries to predict the future. And this astrologer was called Azar. Can you remember that name? You'll find it in the Quran as well. His name's Azar. So Azar, one day, rushes up to Namrud and says, I have seen in the stars that a child is going to be born who is going to take over and change everything we believe in. Namrud said, we can't have any more children. We can't have any more children in this land. You know what? We're going to make sure all moms and all dads live apart. No children. We don't want any children here because I don't want this child to be born to take over my kingship. Well, Azar had a brother whose name was Terah. Terah had his wife was called Sarah and they had a baby. And their baby was called Ibrahim. Azar, when he found out, my goodness, he was so angry. He wanted to go and tell Namrud. Well, Sarah. Now, remember, this is a different Sarah. It is not Ibrahim's wife. This Sarah is Ibrahim's mama. She was called Sarah too. She said, she told to Azar, please don't go tell him. I'm going to go out of town. I will go and take this baby and take him into a cave and we will live out of town. So she went out of town. She took the baby and they hid in a cave. She looked after him, but she kept on coming to town as well. There were times when she would have to leave Ibrahim in that cave. Well, soon after that, some years later, Terah died. And Sarah had to marry Azar. That was the sort of times they were then. She needed somebody to look after her, so she married Azar. Ibrahim, when he was 13, that's Prophet Ibrahim, he comes back to Kutha. Azar is furious. My goodness, what are you doing here? And he thought, okay. And Sarah said, please, come on, he's okay. So he said, well, let's go to the temple and thank God that you are safe, because he thought he had died. Thank God you're alive. So he takes Prophet Ibrahim to the temple and he sees all these idols in this temple and he asks the priests, what are you worshipping? What is this? Can they hear you? Can they help you? And they said, well, we don't know. Our dads and our granddads and our great-granddads, they all used to do it. So we do the same thing as well. And the priests were very, very upset. Azar took Ibrahim home and said, look, these just represent real gods. These are representing, these are idols. Now remember, the whole of Kutha, their economy depended on idols. That means they sold and they bought and sold idols. People bought and sold idols. They sold idols, people bought them. And that's how their livelihood was. People knew Kutha as the place for idols. And guess who was making the idols? Who was the greatest CEO of the firm that made idols? Yeah, you're right, Azar. Well, he thought, let me take Ibrahim back to the temple and maybe he'll get used to it. So he took Ibrahim back to the temple and they went to the roof of the temple and it was evening. And Ibrahim looked out and all the priests were there and he said, looked at the star and he said, is that my God? Oh my God. He said, is that really my God? But then the stars went to sleep. In others, they disappeared in the morning. He said, can't have a God that sleeps. The next night, moon, is that my God? The moon goes away as well. He said, that can't be my God. In the morning, he saw the sun. He said, oh, that's big. That's Akbar. That's massive. Is that my God? And he said, no, that sets as well. Cannot be my God. Now the priests and Azar were really, really angry. And Azar and Ibrahim had a bit of a tiff. And Ibrahim leaves home. And he says, I will ask my Rabb to forgive you. See, he doesn't shout back at his stepdad. He doesn't do that. He just said, I'll ask my Rabb to forgive you. Now, are you with me with the story? So Sarah, that's Ibrahim's mom, had a sister called Waraka. And Waraka had a son and a daughter. The son was called Lut and the daughter was called Sarah. And eventually Ibrahim marries his cousin Sarah. So he marries her, marries her up. And then there was a festival in Kusa. And that was something they had annually. They had this festival and everybody went to the festival. Ibrahim said, I'm not going today. I just don't want to go. He went into the temple and he broke all the gods. He just left the big one there. When the priests came back, they were furious. Who did this? They said, oh, we know of somebody who doesn't like them. And they came to Ibrahim and they said, did you break our idols? He said, why don't you ask the big one? Why don't you ask him who broke the idols? Because he put the hammer around the big one. Oh, they were really angry. And Namrud was really angry as well. And you will find in this surah, let me take you where it says it. So here in ayah 24, look what Allah says. فَمَا كَانَ جَوَابَ قَوْمِهِ. So the answer of his people was, إِلَّا أَنْ كَالُكْتُلُوهُ أَوْ حَرِّكُوهُ. Kill him or burn him. فَأَنْجَاهُ اللَّهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. But Allah saved him. Ah, I'm giving you the story away. So anyway, they were really angry at him. They said, kill him and burn him. So they built a massive fire, like the biggest fire in the whole universe, like massive, okay? It took them days to build this fire. And then it was so hot, they couldn't even go near it. So they put Prophet Ibrahim in a catapult and they catapulted him inside the fire. And there's a couple of stories I like about this. There's a little lizard who took a little bit of water and was spitting it on the fire. And all the other animals said, you're a tiny little lizard. What difference is going to make your little spit of water that goes in the fire? He said, well, at least I can tell Allah I tried my best. Well, here's Ibrahim. He's flying into the fire. And the angel Jibreel says, Ibrahim, do you need help? He said, I don't want help from you. I want help from God. And you know what? Allah had given him a special ring. And in that ring, there was a few things written, like La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim, wa ufawwidhu amri ilallah, and hasbi Allah. And when he lands in the fire, it's like a garden, it's cool. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Surah Al-Anbiya, that's surah number 21, ayah 69, said, Kuni ya naru bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. We told the fire, be cold, be peace for Ibrahim. When you have a temperature, if you ever have a temperature, recite this. Just put your hand on your forehead and say, Kulna ya naru kuni wa bardan, kuni ya kuli ya naru bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. Take your medicine as well, by the way. So, I mean, Namrud is shocked. My goodness, he said, how can somebody not burn? Now he's scared. He says, just go away. I don't want you here. So Ibrahim, Sarah, and Lut, they leave Kusa. So they leave Kusa. They crossed into Egypt. It's a long story, but I hope you remember it or you can listen to it again and again and you'll know it. So they crossed into Egypt and there was a king and the king's name was Arara. And Arara, oh, when he looked at Sarah, she was pretty. And he went to touch her like that. And his hand just froze, just like that. You see my hand? It just froze, just like that. It just froze. He couldn't move it. He told Ibrahim, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. I'm really sorry. I'll never do something like that again, ever. And Ibrahim raises his hands and prays. And his hand, the feeling comes back again. And he says, look, I need you to go, but I'm going to give you a present. Now that time, those are olden times, he gave a person to them. He gave Sarah a slave girl called Hajra. He said, here, you take her and go. And they all went and they settled in Hebron. So you know who they were? Ibrahim, Sarah, Lut, and Hajra. And they lived in Hebron. Sarah really wanted a baby. She really did. And she had told Ibrahim to marry Hajra. And guess who had the baby? Yep, Hajra had a baby. And the baby was called Ismail. It made Sarah sad, really sad. And Ibrahim loved her to bits. He didn't like to see her sad. So with Allah's permission, he takes Hajra and his baby to the valley of Baqa, which is now known as Makkah. And he settles them there. And he leaves them with a bag of water and some dates, or a bag of dates and some water. And she says, is this what my Rabb told you to do? And he says, yes. So she said, go. When they ran out of water, and I've told you this story before, and I'm repeating it. When they ran out of water, she ran between the mountains of Safa and Marwa looking for water. And then she sees this spring coming up near the feet of her child. And she goes, zam, zam, in her language, it meant stop, stop. You'll drown my child. And the water stopped. But today, the water stopped, like nearly drowning it, but it's a spring, it's still there today. So that was basically Hajra. And then he had the dream. Remember, Ibrahim had the dream where he's sacrificing Ismail. And then they built the Kaaba, and there was Maqam-e Ibrahim, my goodness. And his dua has the four P's: the protection, the progeny, the peace. Really important to understand. And the Prophet, these are the four P's that he prayed for. Hajra is buried near the Kaaba. Ismail buried her there. He built a wall around it. And today that's known as Hijra Ismail. Now on the other side, so we had Ismail. Sarah too had a baby. And the baby was called Ishaq. And I'd like to tell you a story about Ishaq, because I've got a little bit of time left. Ishaq was the image of his father. So he looked so much like Prophet Ibrahim. So one day he's looking after his father's sheep. And this person called Maria ibn Aus is passing by. And Maria tells him, hello. Who are you? Assalamu alaikum. Alaikum salam. And he said, my name is Ishaq. I am the son of Prophet Ibrahim. He says, who are you? He said, my name is Maria, and I pray to the God of Ibrahim. And that was it. When Ishaq went home, he told Prophet Ibrahim, you know who I met today? Somebody who prays to your God. And Ibrahim said, I really want to meet him. Well, he said, I want to reach out to him. But he didn't meet him until after 3 years. And 3 years later, he's walking around, he sees this man who's praying, and he comes up to him and he says, how are you? You know, he says, I'm fine, thank you. And he said, where do you live? He said, I live in the island across here. So there was a water and then there was an island. He said, how do you get to the island? He said, I walk on the water. Ibrahim was now amazed. He said, I'll come with you. So both of them go to the edge of the water, and he sees that Maria says, Bismillah. And he steps on the water and he can walk on it. Ibrahim does exactly the same. So Prophet Ibrahim and him both walk to the island. When they get there, they have something to eat. And then Prophet Ibrahim said, let's raise our hands in dua. Let's pray for the guidance and forgiveness for all those who believe in Allah. And when I finish, you say Ameen. And Maria started crying. He said, what good is my prayer? I've been praying for something for 3 years and I'm still waiting. I met his son and I've been praying for it. He said, what are you talking about? Prophet Ibrahim said, what did you pray for? He said, I prayed that one day I would meet Prophet Ibrahim because it's his God I pray to. And Prophet Ibrahim told him, your dua has been answered. I am Ibrahim. And they hugged. You can really remember this. Remember Maria, give his wasila. He prayed and it worked, right? And you know what Prophet Ibrahim told him? Before he told him, I'm Ibrahim, he said, Allah answers all prayers. Sometimes he delays the prayers because he loves your voice. And he thinks that you might stop talking to him like that if he granted you your dua. So because he loves your voice, he delays it for a little bit. And then he asked him, what are you praying for? And he said, Ibrahim. So this was a long story about Ibrahim. Tomorrow, inshallah, we will recite that there's ayat on Prophet Ibrahim, and we will look at Prophet Lut, inshallah. Okay, today we will end with Surat al-Fatiha. We will end with the dua for protection and ziyara of Imam Hussein. So can you please recite with me? A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Close your eyes, ask Allah to give the thawabs to all the marhumins, especially those of your family. Pray for those who are ill and those who are in need. Now the dua for protection. لي خمسة أطفي بها حر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاتمة لي خمسة أطفي بها حر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاتمة السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي علت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. I'll see you inshallah tomorrow at the same time. في أمان الله كريم. Remember, it's time for Asr. Raise your hands in dua. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم.